Well, hello again. Yeah, it's Ugly Sweater Day here on Unsafe Spaces. I'm Randy Cross. Welcome. Glad you could join us. We're going to have a little bit of an unusual segment today because we're going to be talking with Stan Coleman. He's the lead pastor at West Cobb Church. It's the season of Christmas. It's the end of the year. It's usually pretty much a guilt fest. We'll talk a little bit with Stan about that. And we'll have the usual. We'll have the Wambulance and the feel-good story and Unsafe Spaces sports. But starting out here, let's get to the interview segment with Stan Coleman. All righty, welcome. As promised, we're now joined by Stan Coleman, who's the lead pastor at West Cobb Church. Thank you. Thank you for coming. It's kind of the season of the year.
Yeah, my privilege to be here. Busy time of the year, but the craziest time of the year.
Yeah. Do your activities get as nuts? Because it seems like people are always going to a service this time of the year, which, you know, like I say, it's 'tis the season to be jolly, and it's also the season to be guilty.
Yeah.
You know? People got to go to church and
no
say
shame,
sorry.
Like religious shame.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Well, I grew up Catholic, so
yeah.
I know guilt
Catholic
about
guilt.
as well as it comes.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, but so is your activities as a church, do they accelerate the time?
Certainly
of the year?
They do. I mean, we had four services this coming weekend.
Mm-hmm.
So that's four more services. So there's six services this weekend. Just this weekend, we've already had a lot coming on. So yeah, it definitely, it's a busy time of year for pastors, but it's a busy time of year for people.
Mm-hmm.
And the most wonderful time of the year, the year is supposed to be peace on earth and silent night and comfort and joy. I've discovered it's the zaniest, goofiest, craziest, most stress-filled time of the year, right?
Oh, there's no doubt about that.
Yeah.
There's no doubt. Hey, in this area, in the Atlanta area, has come to sort of be known for super churches.
Yeah.
Is a term you hear a
lot.
Yeah,
mega churches.
Uh-huh. Yeah, mega churches.
Yeah.
How's that environment for a church, let's say your size,
right,
compared to some of these places that are just, they've got gigantic footprints in the community?
Yeah, it's great to be, really we're in the buckle of the Bible Belt, if you think about it. And
mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of great churches, North Point Church, multiple churches like Andy Stanley's church and others.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's great for a community to have a big footprint, like you say. But I also think that churches that are our size, 1,000 to 2,000 people,
mm-hmm.
Can really make an impact in communities. A lot of people, we talk about large enough to celebrate, small enough to care.
Mm-hmm.
To your point earlier, you get to this time of the year and you can't even find a parking spot at a church. And so people drive around and they drive somewhere else. So churches like ours can retain some people because of that.
Yeah. Yeah, I would imagine it would make it a little bit easier from that standpoint. But the whole idea with the church, your church specifically, and just doing a little research, very much Bible-based.
Yes.
Correct? And
yes.
I mean, not sort of Bible-based, but Bible is the word.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, very much. We're an evangelical, Bible-believing church. I think one of the distinguishing marks for us would be we're very driven by the gospel. The word gospel means good news. We're driven by the good news of Jesus Christ and what happened that first Christmas.
Yeah, how does the whole idea of grace fit in with what you do?
It's everything. I mean, because really, you know, justice is getting what you deserve,
mm-hmm.
and mercy is getting maybe what you don't deserve, but grace is a free gift. You couldn't earn it, you don't deserve it, and yet God gives it to you. And that's why God came down that first Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
To become one of us. That's the incarnation. So that first Christmas, God literally became one of us. God in a feeding trough, a manger.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty cool deal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What? Where in this whole thing is what you, not only what you deserve, but where is what you earn?
Yeah, I mean, so the Bible says, for by grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourself. It's a free gift. And then it says that you're created to good works. So it's not that you shouldn't do good things, but you don't do them because you have to. You do them because you get to and you want to because He changed your life.
It's not about a scoreboard.
It's not about keeping a checklist or a scoreboard. So to your point earlier is you were raised Catholic.
Yeah.
So we had Catholics in our small group in our home. And so she said, for years we were raised Catholic, but we came to your church, and we discover that we love the Lord, but we do it now because we want to go to church, and we get to go to church, and we want to write a check, and we want to do good things. Not we have to, but we get to.
Yeah.
See the difference?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
I do. I know there was an article that came out a while ago.
Yeah.
That was kind of a good news, bad news.
Right.
You know, from the bad news standpoint, I always thought Atlanta would rank a lot higher on this list.
Yeah.
But the AJC did an article where Atlanta was ranked number 6 and most sinful cities in America.
Yeah.
Are you surprised by that?
Yeah, I was shocked initially, and then I drilled down for
a few. Did it sound low or high?
It sounded like we were rated too high. Because if you think of sin, I glanced at the article again. There's 37 different indicators, right? Vice, yeah. Violence, greed, lust, gambling, mm-hmm. go on and on, right?
Yeah.
The 7 deadly sins and more.
My brain, I'm going, yeah, check.
Check, check. Check. Yeah, for check. All of us. Yeah.
Yeah.
In fact, we have a little motto at our church, no perfect people allowed. So there's no perfect people.
No.
There's also no perfect churches. Yeah. You know, if you find one and join it, it's not going to be perfect anymore.
Be careful.
Be careful. Yeah. You know, as a pastor, my favorite definition of the church is a colossal collection of moral foul ups gathered together for grace.
Mm-hmm.
So to that point, you ask, am I shocked? I was initially shocked that, of course, the most sinful city in America, we think of Sin City, would be what?
Las Vegas.
Yeah, Las Vegas. And it came out number one. Then L.A. and New York, mm-hmm. Houston, and then all of a sudden Atlanta, right here in the Bible Belt.
Yeah.
And so, and what I looked again at that article, number 2 in jealousy, number 4 city in America in lust.
As a metric.
Yeah.
How the heck do you judge jealousy?
Yeah. Well,
I know it's in your life and the people you're around, that's usually kind of easy to judge.
Yeah, it's coveting, it's the Housewives of Atlanta, it's that whole, the vanity has a part of it, the pride that I'm entitled to this, and so I'm jealous that you have it, so I should have it.
Yeah, or here's what I have, you can never do this, ha
yeah,
ha ha,
sure.
Kind of attitude.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, pride,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. All of that.
Yeah, so you said there were 35 different
Yeah, 37 metrics, different 37? Indicators, yeah, right.
Wow, mm-hmm. That's burying down pretty deep.
Yeah.
But with what we just talked about,
it
does kind of make it, when you think about it, surprising with the presence that churches have in this community.
But the problem, Randy, I think...
Is there a duality to people?
See, I think we're a very religious community, mm-hmm. but there's a difference between religion and a relationship, okay? Religion is, I do this religiously. In fact, the Bible, there's a guy in the Bible that people know.
We're back to guilt again.
We're back to guilt a little bit.
Yeah.
There's a guy who had very little guilt. He had all the religion. He was circumcised on the 8th day. He was a member of the religious class, the Pharisees, of the tribe of Benjamin. His name was Saul. Saul hated Christ and hated Christians, but he was very religious. So he got on a donkey and he was traveling to a city called Damascus,
mm-hmm.
and God literally knocked Saul off his ass, okay?
Right.
Literally, okay?
Literally.
And he changed his life and gave him grace, and his name was changed from Saul to Paul. He wrote more of the New Testament than anyone else, okay?
Right.
So Paul is talking to the most sinful city in the culture of that day. It was the city of Corinth, okay? Corinth would make Las Vegas look like a kid's playground, basically,
right.
Okay? So in 1 Corinthians...
And this is pre-Sodom and Gomorrah, right?
This is post, yeah. So there definitely was Sodom and Gomorrah in the Old Testament would be Sin City, Corinth in the New Testament.
In the New Testament,
in the first century culture of Jesus' day.
Okay.
And so here's what Paul said, and I'm relating this to the 6th most sinful city in America, Atlanta, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Paul said, the strength of sin is the law. Think about that. If right now it says, wet paint, do not touch, what is Randy and Stan thinking about doing?
Testing it out
a little, okay?
Yeah.
So the law, you say I can't do it, I'm going to show you. And so in Atlanta, we have a lot of religion and a lot of law.
Mm-hmm.
People live under the law. It's what I'm going to do for God. But they haven't really worked on their relationship with God. They haven't let grace change them from the inside out. Went to church, check. Catholic guilt, check. Wrote a check, check, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's not the relationship. And so I believe Jesus came not to make bad men good, but to give dead men life.
Hmm. That's pretty good. That's very good, actually. Question for me in this area. Can you take advantage of kind of that intersection of religion and sports?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, goodness knows there's a lot of very good people that are involved on the sports side that take a lot of heat because they don't hesitate to bring up their religious beliefs.
Right. Well, the Bible says, whatever you do, do it with all of your heart and do it for the glory of God. You can take anything. See, so, you know, a lot of people think, for example, one time someone said, how many ministers do you have at your church? I said, right now we have 1,200. They're like, wow. Everyone who's really a part of our church is a minister, okay? And so for you, it might be you minister through broadcasting, or you minister with football, or you minister with the sport of golf. And so as you go, the Bible says, as you go, make disciples. Mm-hmm. And so I believe that religion and sports can come together. You think of all the great stories and people giving God the glory. You got, you know, the Alabama quarterbacks, that whole story that just happened with Tua and Jalen.
Jalen, yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Things like that. They're just making an impact because they're putting God in the midst of their sports.
What is it that has given such a negative connotation out there, do you believe, to being that proud of what you believe in religiously? Yeah. That there's, it's almost like a stigma. You know, the best example that's still out there is Tim Tebow.
Yeah.
You know, Tim was never hesitant about that.
Right.
He had the eye black thing that they stopped him from wearing because of that.
John 3:16.
3:16. But see, he always, when he gets a chance, he's always professing, you know, his faith and what he believes in.
Yes.
But that's perceived as a negative.
Yeah. Well, the gospel has always been offensive. It's offensive. You mean to tell me, see, because we think...
You mean like, baby, it's cold outside offensive?
Yeah, yeah, romaine lettuce offensive, whatever.
Yeah, all that.
Yeah, it's offensive. Because we think it's about us. Think about it. Adam and Eve were told, you can do anything except one thing. Don't eat the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Any other tree. So what do? The serpent goes, God didn't really say that. You don't need to believe that. So they chose so we've been doing the same thing. We do the same thing. We make the wrong choices. So we think it's about us, and we can choose better than God. So we have a problem with glory. We're confused about glory. We were made for the glory of God, but we live for our own glory.
Mm-hmm. Does any of that tie into the Atlantis number 6?
Absolutely.
On the list,
I think
because I know you've done some sermons about this, right?
Yeah, a little bit.
But the reality is,
I don't think when I say our big issue isn't sin, I don't mean that sin isn't a problem. I think our problem is we don't believe God. We don't believe God is who he says he is, that he did what he said he would do, that God literally sent his own son, Jesus, that first Christmas. He became one of us, right? He lived the life we could never live, the perfect life. He died on a cross, which means Jesus absolved all of God's wrath against that sin, that sinful city, for us. And on the third day, he was raised from the dead. This is why I say Jesus didn't come to make bad men good, but to give dead people life.
Yeah. I mean, it's having grown, like I said, I was Catholic growing up, studied a lot of the Bible, and had periods in my life back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, it's really interesting being raised Catholic. My perception was always as far as repenting.
Yeah.
And taking like Jesus in your life.
Yes.
And recognizing his place. To falling out of a building. And if I'm falling out of a building, as long as I say I'm sorry by the time I hit the ground, before I hit the ground, I'm saved.
Yeah.
You know, that was the old Catholic way of thinking about it, because you had to say, I'm sorry.
That's funny.
And you had to say, I accept.
Yeah. So I had never been to a Catholic church because I grew up in Baptist churches. Okay.
Yeah.
And so I went to a Catholic mass because I was going to plant a church in South Florida.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to 12 different churches, and a Catholic church was one of them. And this happened, no lie. There was some holy water. You know how you get water? You boil the hell out of it, right?
Yeah, okay. Right there at the end.
Right. So
going
he dipped his fingers in it and did this, I guess, the
sign of the cross.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I overheard him whisper, good for another week. Good for another week. And I thought,
he is Catholic.
He is Catholic. Okay, okay. But here's what's cool. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished. It's done. It's taken care of. So I think what we have to recognize, we still sin, but Jesus already took care of that. So you've already, think about this, you've already been forgiven for every sin you've ever committed, are committing, or ever will commit. It's a done deal.
Yeah.
You just got to walk in that. You have to appropriate that. You don't beg for forgiveness. It's already been made available.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So why the need for a story about things like the rapture?
Yeah.
Then if you've already been forgiven, wouldn't everybody disappear at that time?
Well, so you've been forgiven, but the problem is that some people haven't received the gift of grace.
Okay.
There's more than enough forgiveness available by the blood of Jesus that he shed.
Right.
But you've got to believe it and receive it for yourself. Okay. Mm-hmm. Not just because your dad was a preacher, your dad was a deacon, or your mom was a Sunday school teacher. That doesn't get you into heaven.
Yeah.
You know, when God says, why should I let you in? You don't go, well, my dad really believed, or, you know, I had a Bible. You know, yeah. It's what did you do with it? Did you believe it and receive it for yourself?
Yeah. From that perspective, also, I went to church every Sunday.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's not perfect attendance day. No, it really doesn't matter.
It's really not. Well, he may say, depart from me, I never knew you. Because again, it's not about religion, it's about a relationship.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's fantastic. I really appreciate you joining me, and this is the perfect time of the year.
Yeah.
For the holidays to do it. And
well, thank you for the invite. Yeah. Christmas is the fulfillment of all the promises of God found in Jesus. Thanks for the invite.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay. Well, thank you to Stan once again. That was good stuff. I hope you enjoyed it. It's something that I think this time of the year, it's not a bad thing to reflect. I've always made fun of those people that kind of found religion every Easter and Christmas, and I guess I am one of them. But, hey, thanks, Stan. Appreciate you coming in and just helping us out a little bit. As to, you know, if anything else, why Atlanta's number 6? All right. Time now to go to Unsafe Spaces Sports. Seeing as this is the last show of 2018, we're going to do a quick review of the important bowl games. Now, they're called the New Year's Six for a reason. Well, besides the fact there's 6 of them, obviously, right? They're all played on or around New Year's. And they are the major bowl games. Now, in case you don't know, there are 40 bowl games, and a lot of which have the most hilarious or inane or unbelievable sponsor names attached to them. But there are 34 other bowls, some of which have already been played at this airing, that are played every year. So do the math. More than half of everybody that plays and at the FBS level plays in a bowl game. So you want to talk about everybody gets a trophy? That's the bowl season. Because it started December 15th, and it'll go all the way through the national championship game, which is in early January. All right, let's go through the games. Number 1 on the hit parade is here in Atlanta. Last year, it was the scene of a great upset, UCF beating Auburn. This year, it's a really nice matchup between Michigan and Florida. Michigan sort of trying to get that taste of that Ohio State drubbing out of their mouth. Florida's been a team that just sort of has hung around, especially from the rankings standpoint, earning themselves a New Year's Six Bowl game. I anticipate Florida winning this game. It's going to be a defensive-oriented game, though you really can't tell in bowl games because, remember, these kids haven't played, in some cases, 3-4 weeks by the time these games start. Was their last time on the field. So in many cases, you see a totally different team. Second game on our list of the New Year's Six is the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl. And that's going to have, speaking of everybody getting a trophy, UCF representing the group of 5, undefeated 25-game winning streak. I mentioned last year they went to the Peach Bowl and beat Auburn, really fueled their whole national champion claim last year. And fueled a lot of what they've done this year. They're going to be without Mackenzie Milton. I think Daryl Mack Jr., their quarterback, did a great job in that Memphis game leading them back. Be a totally different animal, I believe, against LSU. I love the UCF story. And I know UCF fans probably see this, will be nodding, going, yeah, he's not going to pick us. And you'd be right. I'm going to go with LSU. I think LSU will be a lot more motivated than Auburn was last year. Not really a guess, I think more of a fact. And I think LSU wins that Fiesta Bowl out there in Arizona. Next up on the list, and you'll notice this theme, there's always a sponsor involved, but it's the Allstate Sugar Bowl. Texas, great story, the way they've rallied under Tom Herman this year against Georgia, coming off that tough loss against Alabama. Georgia finished 11-2. Fantastic year, but not quite good enough. And they'll go against Texas. I think Texas is going to see a running game like they haven't seen before. Texas will score a good bit. Georgia will just score a bit more. I think it's somewhere in the 35-28, 35-27 kind of range. Next up of the New Year's Six bowl games will be Ohio State and Washington out in the granddaddy of them all, the Rose Bowl. You'll notice something on the logo. You'll see a sponsor on the field, but it's one of the exceptions to the rule nowadays in these New Year's Six bowl games. You don't have a huge corporate slap over the top of it. Ohio State, really, really good. Washington, pretty good defensive team. Washington won the Pac-12. They're not going to win this one. I think Ohio State's just got too much offense for them and enough defense to slow them down to where it's probably a 12 to 14 point win by Ohio State. Next up on the list of games for the New Year's Six is the two big ones. Now, they're on December 29th, the night of December 29th. First game is going to start around 4:30. Alabama and Oklahoma are going to play in the Orange Bowl, and this will be a great game. This will be high scoring. You're going to see the Heisman Trophy winner. Murray's going to be in that game. Alabama, Tua Tagovailoa actually practiced for Alabama here recently, so chances are you may see him starting the game. But Kyler Murray, the Heisman Trophy winner, will be the highlight of this game. Win or lose, watching this kid play is always special. And I say win or lose, I anticipate Oklahoma's going to lose this game and Alabama's going to win. And in the other semifinal game, which is going to be played down in Texas, the Cotton Bowl, the Goodyear Cotton Bowl, is Clemson against Notre Dame. And this is kind of like UCF shot going against LSU again to make it 26 games in a row. Notre Dame and Clemson, both these teams are undefeated. And it's a matter of can Notre Dame sort of put up or shut up. They haven't faced a defense like Clemson. They haven't faced a team like Clemson. I think Notre Dame's going to show out pretty well. They're going to do a really good job. They just don't have enough guns to go against this type of a football team. I think Clemson early will struggle a bit with Notre Dame. By the time this thing's all over, it's about a 10-point win for the Clemson Tigers, and that sets up the third time in the national championship game in the last few years. It's going to be Clemson and Alabama. I know. Well, perfect lead-in to the Wambulance. Now, if you follow the news, especially the tech news and the science news, there's been a lot of stuff about artificial intelligence and a lot of stuff about robotics and how much it's changed. And we've all seen that robot that can now jump onto boxes and it can run full speed, it can cut on a dime and all that. Well, there was a sports fair or a science fair in Russia, highly touted about how far robotics have come. Now, you're going to see this feature, and it will have a lot of graphics that are going to be in acrylic. It'll be in Russian. You won't be able to read them, but you will hear a bit of a narration from a news standpoint. And let's just say Russian science got embarrassed a bit.
Russian state TV is defending a broadcast that appeared to suggest a robot at a tech forum was real. A reporter said during the broadcast the hope was more youth would get involved in robotics after seeing the state-of-the-art robot. On social media, people raised questions about the dancing robot, including why it had no sensors and how it was made so quickly. A photo of the robot also appeared to show a human neck and hair peeking out from the helmet. Through research by journalists and members of the public, the robot was revealed to be a man in a costume. The forum organizers said they had never claimed the robot was real. 2 days after the broadcast, the TV station said it knew all along a man was inside the quote-unquote robot. And the reporter, who had given the impression the robot was real, says he thought most people would assume it was really just an actor in a costume. According to the costume's maker, the product gives a, quote, almost complete illusion that you have a real robot, end quote.
Don't you think the semi-Star Wars crew shirts that all the attendees are wearing really kind of puts the cherry on top of that sundae? So yeah, a little bit of a problem. Not quite where they said they were as far as robotics went, but hey, what's a little embarrassment? Makes it a lot funner for those of us that love to look at stuff like that and kind of have a little enjoyment at the misery of others' mistakes, you know? I know the pastor probably wouldn't like that, but I got to bring that up. All right, now speaking of mistakes and things that are really good, let's go to our feel-good story of the week. Now, we've featured Rodney Smith Jr. in the past, and that was based around his 50 Lawns and 50 States program, where he literally was driving around the country cutting lawns for veterans that really need the service. It's a huge hit. It spawned kids around the country doing the exact same thing in their communities. This guy, to say he has a heart of gold and a gigantic heart would be a gross understatement. But if you haven't heard about what he's doing, granting Christmas wishes, check this out.
They may not be on your Christmas list, and maybe they don't think they're on anyone's, but that is about to change. Rodney Smith Jr. brought his small tree and his giant heart to Baltimore, part of a national tour bringing Christmas to America's homeless. The Bermuda-born Alabama resident whose calling is to give.
Last year, I traveled to all the major cities in Alabama dressed as Santa Claus, giving out gifts, and this year I decided to take it to all 50 states.
Through online donations, and there must be a ton of them.
Poncho, toothpaste.
He is not just giving out backpacks and blankets. This man is granting wishes.
They want hot showers, so I buy them 3-night stays in hotel rooms. I bought a few bus tickets back home. There was two gentlemen in Idaho who's been homing for 6 months up there, and they just wanted to get back home to Florida so they can get back on their feet. So I bought them bus tickets, and there's been a few that wanted cell phones so they can get in contact with their family.
Rodney Smith Jr., bringing Christmas to the streets. A bench in Baltimore this week, Hawaii and Alaska next week.
Yeah, congratulations to Rodney Smith. What a fantastic thing that he does, his lawn program, and this one here. And if you want to know how to donate to Hope for the Holidays, there's the dates they'll be doing it and the website, hopefortheholidaystour.com. Hopesfortheholidaystour.com is where you would go to help donate to Rodney's program and be a little part of what he's doing for homeless all over the country. Good on you, Rodney. Fantastic stuff. God, I love it. All right, want to remind you where you have found us. Pretty easy to say. It's unsafespacesusa.com, randycross.com. Also, you can find us on YouTube, SoundCloud, iTunes, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We're not omnipresent, but we're getting pretty close as far as the availability of what you can get at, where you can get us. Any suggestions on stories or content, that should go to producer@unsafespacesusa.com. Two things coming up here as we hit Happy Trails. We're going to hit you with the cats again, and don't forget, water your Christmas tree. Have a great 2019.
Happy Trails.